my position there is
okay, ShEx by sample. Okay. So just to say that, as I was saying, that you have this book about RDF and you have the online version, and most of the things are from this chapter. ShEx, I did almost the introduction. The idea of ShEx is that this is a domain-specific language. It was defined specifically for this, for describing and validating RDF data. You have there the different links, and you have different serializations. I think this is, I can skip all of this, and just to say that there are a lot of implementations. One of those implementations is ShEx-S, is that the one that I did, but there is another one, ShEx-JS, and another one in Java, Python, and different languages. And also, if you want to play, there are different online demos. I will use here the RDF shape, because that's the one that we developed in my working group, in my research group in Hueso. And so I will later show it how it works. Okay, so this is a very simple example in ShEx. You have the shape of a user. You can have two properties, which is the name, which is a string, and knows another user. And for me, the important thing here is that you can have a cyclic data model where you have a user knows another user, and this is interesting from my point of view, and this is one of the core things of ShEx, and one of the things that will differentiate ShEx from Shackle, because Shackle in the recommendation, the use of cyclic data models was left as an implementation dependent feature. Okay, so this is the shape, and I wanted to say here, so also you also have prefix declarations, which are the same as in Turtle. Okay, so now let's go with the sample. Imagine you have this data, you have here you have Alice, which has the name Alice, knows Alice, and all this data, and then later you have this shape map, and the shape map is the way that we tell the system that we want to validate this data. So imagine that you want to say, okay, I have this, for example, I have this node Alice here. I want to validate Alice as with the shape of a user. So this is the shape and this is the node. And let's start. I mean, if you want to, we can just do it very fast. If we want to check if Alice is a user, what we are going to go is to go to the shape of user. In this case, it says that it must have an IRI, a property name, which is a string, and knows another user. Here, by default, the same here, notice that we have a cyclic data model, and the system will say that it is okay, because Alice knows Alice, and we assume that Alice is already a user, and it validates. Then we have Bob as a user. The validator would find here Bob, and he knows Alice. Alice was already validated as a user, so and has the name Robert. Notice that here I exchanged the order of the triples. So here, instead of name and knows, I put first knows and later name. But there is no problem because we are talking about graphs. And in the graphs, the order of the arcs is not relevant. So you could have any order, and here it validates. Then we have here Carol has the two names and doesn't know anyone. There is no problem if she doesn't know anyone, because we have a star, so it allows zero or more. But there is a problem because it has two names, and we put here by default in ShEx the cardinality is one. So if you don't say anything, you only allow one value of name. So here Carol would fail. Okay, so this is going to fail. Then we also have Dave that has the name is an integer. And this only has one name, but the name is an integer, so Dave is going to fail also. In the case of Emily, Emily has a property name, which is different from a schema colon name, so this is also going to fail. So this is going to fail. Then we go to Frank, and Frank has a name, which is a string, an email, which is a URI, and knows two people, which are Alice and Bob. Notice that Frank has a single name, which is a string, and knows two users. So in principle, you could say, okay, it conforms to the same user, but notice that you have a different property that was not listed here in the shape. And this is one of the first things that when we started to implement the ShEx, Eric's implementation didn't have any problem with this, and his implementation allowed extra properties, but for example, my implementation didn't allow extra properties. In the implementation I did in Scala, I was more inspired by XML, and I thought that if you had other properties that were not defined in this data model, you should reject them. Eric's, as I said, was more, his implementation was more permissive, and he allowed extra properties, but we disagreed there. And at the end, what we decided is by default. So if you don't say anything, you will allow extra properties. So if you have extra properties that don't appear in the shape, you have no problem, you can accept them. But you could have here a qualifier. You could say, okay, but let's say that this is closed. And if I say that the shape is closed, if the shape is closed, then I will reject this. Okay, so by default, this is open by default, this is Frank will validate. And finally, we have Grace. Grace knows Alice, which is a user, has a string name, but knows someone, which is a node, and this is a blank node, and we had said here that the user should be an IRI. So this is a node constraint, this is a constraint on the node, that this is says that it must be an IRI, and in this case, it will fail. Okay, so this was the first example of ShEx. I think it's quite intuitive, and you can play with shapes. In RDF shape, but probably I was looking to the time, and maybe if we want to go fast, maybe I'm not going to play with it with RDF shape by now. But just an overview of what we did is that we have the three inputs. We have the schema, we also have the shape map, we also have the RDF data. We put this in a validator, and we obtained a result, and the result was also a shape map. So let's see now how it works. We go to rdfshape.weso.es. I think this is the sample from the book. I think this is the same example. And this is the RDF shape, the same example that I was talking. Maybe I added the gender of also, so you can play with it. And now notice that here you can play. So I wanted to have some time here to talk about RDF shape. You can play, for example, imagine you have Alice, but if you want to change, also this information is not relevant. You can put here Alice two names. And then you try to validate. Notice that here Alice was validated, but now Alice will not validate because it has two names. So you can play with this tool. And this is the, as I said, you have three inputs, the shape map, the shapes graph, the ShEx, the schema, and the RDF input. Okay, so this is a tool that you can use to play with shape expressions. And this tool, RDF shape, you can use it to play with ShEx, with Shaker, with ShapeMass, also with Wikidata, etc. Okay. So more things about, and this is another bigger example with more ShEx features. For the people who connected late, I have to say that all the slides, you have all the slides in the web page of the tutorial. I added to the web page of the tutorial, I added the slides yesterday. So you can, I was just updating them. Okay, so this is a more, and probably with this I will finish the introduction to ShEx. The information, for example, imagine that you want to say that you have an adult person which has an RDF type, which is must be a schema, a person from a schema. Then you have a string, which is the name. The age is the less than 18. Sorry, bigger than 18. The gender is male, female, or a string. You have an address, which is which must have the shape of an address, and works for a company. And then you want to this data, and this data will you could check that it conforms. One thing that I wanted to show here is that in RDF shape, I found it quite useful to represent shapes as UML diagrams, so you can visualize those shapes here, and let's see if it works. So also in the slides I tried to add URLs. Okay, so this is the sample, so this is the shape, but if you want to visualize this shape, you can visualize the ShEx schema. You can have this visual representation of ShEx schemas. This is something that I will probably explain later about shapes, applications, and tools. I notice that you can play with this. You can add other fields, for example, code, which must be the integer. If you add some fields, notice that the visualization will have a company which has a name and the code. You can also, for example, say that you have whatever country, and this is has a country, and then later you have another shape, country. Let's keep it empty by now, and now the visualization will have here the company, a property country that went. So these diagrams you can generate then from the shape expressions. And we have also another tool that was quite recently that converts ShEx to UML, and this conversion is done using XMI. So the XMI is the XML representation of UML, and then you can export that XMI to use that in, for example, in some tools like Visual Paradigm or whatever. So this was the introduction to shape expressions and the tools that we had. And as I said, I will just do a very quick review of ShEx, but probably I will skip some of the details. ShEx has a compact syntax, but also has a JSON-LD and an RDF syntax. So at the end, if you have, this is the compact syntax, but you have an equivalent JSON-LD, which is also equivalent to RDF syntax. So just to review, the case of ShEx, we have shape expressions, we have labels of these shape expressions. I can skip this one about shape maps. In the case of the shape maps, we have like a language for shape maps where the basic form is, for example, Alice as at user, but you can also do more complex things. For example, you can say, I want to validate all the subjects of nodes as users. So you can say that the focus is the subjects of the property nodes, and you can validate that. So at the end, what you do when you have more complex shape maps, you take the RDF data, you resolve the shape map, and then you obtain a fixed shape map. And at the end, the validator works in two parts. So you have the query shape map, you resolve the shape map with the RDF data, then you have this fixed map, and with the shape expressions you validate that. That's the way it works. And also something which I find, this I added this part this year to the slide, is that in the case of same maps, you can also do this thing which some people who know Sparkle already find very useful. Imagine that you want to validate all the nodes that that knows someone, and you do want to do that with a Sparkle query. You can do in the same in the query maps, you can put a Sparkle query, and then all the nodes that are searched by this Sparkle query are going to be validated as users. Okay, so this is probably something that, for example, in Wikidata, a lot of people do this. In Wikidata, they do a Sparkle query to Wikidata to obtain nodes, and then those nodes that have been obtained are going to be validated by a schema, by an entity schema. Okay, and then this is the part that I will probably skip, because otherwise we are going to be out of time. So you also have node constraints. Triple constraints are constraints on triples. And then you also have the predicates, value constraints. And at the end, you have shape expressions. This is the language. It's not a very complex language. I mean, sometimes it's complex, the implementation, but the language itself, we try it to be intuitive. And with this, we probably skip. I'm skipping most of the slides just to see if there is something that I want to say. Probably, if you follow the slides, you have examples there, and you don't need. Okay. So I'm going to skip this part, and let's go to Shackle.